Hi. So today we want to think about Zen Buddhism, this remarkable, bracing, stripped down form of East Asian Buddhism that we mostly associate with Japan. The word Zen is a Japanese word, but it's really an unfolding of an earlier Chinese iteration of Buddhism called Chan Buddhism, which goes all the way back, of course, to India in the 5th century BCE, you know, Siddhartha Gautama, the Buddha. And in fact, it's there that we find this story, a story often told in Zen Buddhism, which somehow perfectly encapsulates its pillar of wordless transmission. And the story is often called the Flower Sermon. So the story goes that one day the Buddha gathered his students together for another talk, for a Dharma talk, as he often did. But on this day, he didn't say a word. He simply held up a flower. And one man, Kashyapa, signaled with his eyes that he understood what was being said. I can only imagine all the other monks squirming in awkwardness, like, what is this? In fact, I was thinking about doing this video that way, like, why don't I just come on and not say a word and just hold a flower for 20 minutes? See how many likes and views I get. So, no, let's not do that. I love that story though, and that story is a touchstone for Zen Buddhists. They often repeat that story, and in fact, it is Kashyapa who was chosen as the second patriarch after the Buddha, because he received somehow through spiritual osmosis, that's what the Katha Upanishad calls it, that mysterious transmission of wordless awareness between teachers and students, between anybody. That shared experience that words and language and doctrines and talks can't touch. Yeah? So that's where Zen Buddhism starts, with the flower sermon, the Buddha simply holding up a flower and hoping that people realize what is being said. So the word Zen in Japanese comes from an earlier Chinese word, Chan. And Chan is itself a Chinese translation of an earlier Indian or Sanskrit term, dhyana, meaning meditation. We've already thought about how the art and the science and the practice of meditation is so central to really all Buddhism, but it becomes kind of all that's left in Zen Buddhism after they strip everything out. They strip out worship and ornate temples and all the accoutrement of religiosity. They sort of ditch all that and go for an austere, bare bones, sit down and meditate and realize your Dharmakaya, realize your Buddha consciousness. That's the through line of Zen Buddhism all the way back to the time of the Buddha. So there was one teacher though where we kind of shine a spotlight whenever we think about Zen Buddhism. And that teacher's name is Bodhidharma. And he is the 28th patriarch after the Buddha. He's an Indian Buddhist teacher, the 28th patriarch, who, so the story goes, left India and traveled to China. And when he got to China, around 500 CE, so this is 1,000 years after the Buddha, there's already Buddhism in China. There's Mahayana Buddhism. A particular emperor named Emperor Wu was pretty committed to Buddhism as he understood it. And he had, out of his own wealthy coffers, funded enormous ornate temples and gilded versions of the sutras. And he funded vast monasteries and big giant statues of the Buddha. And he was so thrilled to learn that this Indian Buddhist teacher, Bodhidharma, had come to his region. And so the emperor called him into his palace, and the emperor excitedly showed Bodhidharma everything that he had done for Buddhism, the temples and all of that. And Emperor Wu said to Bodhidharma, what merit will I get from all of this? And of course, Bodhidharma said, no merit at all. That the value of Buddhism is not in worship. It is not in how much money you put into it. It is not in all of these outer forms. It's about an inner transformation. So Bodhidharma sort of sets the stage for Chan Buddhism in China out of that story, which will travel across the water to Japan a few centuries later, where it becomes known as Zen Buddhism. And as we mentioned before, Dhyana, Chan, Zen, the emphasis in Zen Buddhism is on meditation. Why? Because meditation is our best shot at experiencing reality as it actually is, not as it appears to be when filtered through the grid of the conceptual mind. Zen Buddhism emphasizes this again and again and again in countless ways, that when we look out at the world, what we call ordinary experience, we are seeing what is, we are seeing reality through a filtering system comprised of our conditioning, our concepts, our prejudices, our acculturation. We do not see things as they are, the Jewish Book of Wisdom, the Talmud points out. We do not see things as they are. We see things as we are. Or as Shakespeare put it, the world is jaundiced through jaundiced eyes. Meditation bypasses the conceptual grid. And when we sit quietly in meditation, we begin to experience that depth awareness, which is not thoughts, it is not concepts, it is not perception. It is the, as we called it before, it is what Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita called the inner witness of not only our own conceptual distortions, but the reality which runs through those conceptual distortions. So meditation is the practice par excellence in Zen Buddhism. That's why it's right there in the name. Now, when you first begin to study Zen Buddhism, you bump into this teacher that we mentioned already, Bodhidharma, quite a bit. And he's credited with coming up with this four-point definition of Zen Buddhism. One, Zen Buddhism is a special transmission outside the scriptures. So there's that idea we've been thinking about so many times here, ineffability. Whatever wisdom is, it sure cannot be written down. So the scriptures are neat and everything, and they're cool, and they're like cookbooks. You know, they're good for recipes, but you can't eat them. They're not the food. Or as Alan Watts puts it, you know, the map is not the place. So as holy as the scriptures may be, they do not actually contain, in the Zen perspective, anything of real value. They are all fingers pointing at the moon. And only an idiot would confuse this finger with the moon. That's a line you hear in Zen Buddhism a lot too. So that was the first idea Bodhidharma came up with when asked to define Zen. A special transmission outside the scriptures, in the same way that the flower sermon was a special transmission outside the scriptures. Two, Zen Buddhism is not dependent on words or letters. Kind of a echo of that first idea, but he puts it even more firmly here. Whatever Zen Buddhism is, it is not dependent on words or letters. Three, Zen Buddhism is a direct pointing to the heart. A direct pointing. Again, that idea of getting around the grid of explanation and conceptualization, and a direct pointing at the heart. And again, the heart is just a metaphor, right? You know, don't get too literal here, like, oh, the heart? Or then now we're in some sort of romantic emotional space. A direct pointing at the essence. And number four, seeing into one's nature and the realization of Buddhahood. Uncovering one's essential nature. And they do that in Zen Buddhism in countless ways. There are these things called koans, K-O-A-N, kind of riddles that you can't solve, like What did your face look like before your parents were born? And the Zen master would send the adept, would send the student away. Go think about that question and come back in 3 days and explain it to me. And of course, the question can't be answered. It's designed strictly to confuse, to tie the conceptual mind in knots. And then you just sit back and you laugh and you go, oh, there is no answer. I'm on the wrong road. I'm on the wrong path. I'm trying to unlock the mystery of existence with rational discourse, logic, language, and concepts. It can't be done. And in fact, I'm wasting a lot of time by trying to do it. So that's the essential definition of Zen from the great first patriarch of Zen Buddhism, as he's now known, Bodhidharma. And then after him come a long line of these great teachers through the Chinese tradition of Chan Buddhism, and later the Japanese tradition of Zen Buddhism. The monastic tradition emerges, monasteries are built, people go there to practice meditation, and a whole Zen aesthetic works its way into Chinese and Japanese culture, and it shows up in later Japanese medieval forms in the samurai movement, in the tea ceremony, in the design of Japanese gardens and Japanese architecture. Zen Buddhism becomes the aesthetic of so much of East Asian culture and cuisine and dance and calligraphy and painting and on and on and on. In fact, arguably, Taoism, the Chinese tradition of Taoism, is the seedbed into which these Indian seeds of Buddhism fall. And when the seeds of Indian Buddhism fall in the indigenous soil of Chinese Taoism, up grows this distinctly East Asian form of Buddhism, which has lots of Taoism in it. And so all of that wonderful yin and yang and wu wei stuff that we were thinking about before, those become notable flavors in East Asian Buddhism, particularly Chan and Zen Buddhism, that maybe we didn't detect very much of in those earliest first forms of Buddhism way back in the 5th century BCE in India. Buddhism in the Zen form is about experience, not conceptualization. Like, there's a great line from the wonderful Zen master and Japanese Zen poet, Matsuo Basho, a 17th century poet, really the master of the form called haiku. But this is not a haiku, but he leaves us with this wonderful line that often comes to mind when I reflect on these questions. He said, "Do not seek to follow in the footsteps of the wise men of old. Instead, seek what they sought." So there, Basho is trying to pull us out of what I think is kind of a natural default human condition or human tendency, the tendency toward devotion, the tendency toward celebrity worship, hero worship. Let me touch the hem of your garment and then I can be where you are. You see Jesus wrestling this within the Gospels. Show us where the kingdom of heaven is so we can be like you. You know, that idea that who I am and what I am is not good enough until I become you, O master, O teacher, O savior, O bodhisattva. And again, you see these spiritual students and spiritual teachers pushing back against that kind of default devotional energy. I'm not saying devotion can't be a powerful transformational tool. We've seen that with our earlier discussions of karma yoga in the Hindu tradition. But Zen Buddhism isn't going there. It's not about devotion toward the Buddhist. There's a contemporary book about Zen Buddhism that has a pretty catchy title. It's called, "If You Meet the Buddha on the Road, Kill Him." That even the idea of Buddhahood needs to be abandoned. Even the idea of me attaining enlightenment needs to be abandoned, because then Buddhism is just another acquisition path. It's about me moving from my crummy life to my enlightened life, you know. And Zen Buddhism is like, hold on here. That whole mechanical structure, that whole conceptual framework you're building, namely, I need to get from my ignorant, unenlightened self to the mountaintop of enlightenment. Turning enlightenment into a goal is a mistake. That's the Zen Buddhist perspective. We don't meditate in Zen Buddhism in order to become enlightened. Meditation is its own reward. And that, again, I guess, breaks the habit that the first and second noble truth of Buddhism reminded us of, that when I crave from the ego, I generate my own suffering. So there is one final piece of Zen wisdom I'll leave with you. It's from a classic Zen work called The Gateless Gate. The Gateless Gate. Yeah, don't you love it? So much mind-bending paradox, like, built into the Zen the Zen body of work. That line from The Gateless Gate goes like this: a dunce, an idiot, once searched for a fire with a lighted lantern. Had he known what fire was, he could have cooked his rice much sooner. It reminds me of a line from the Upanishads that we are like kings and queens suffering from amnesia, wandering through our kingdom in tatters, not knowing who we are. Or we are like sleeping dreamers. And in our dream, we wander the earth searching for our lost loved one. All the while, they're lying right next to us. All we have to do is wake up. So Zen Buddhism is an austere, stripped-down form of Buddhism that jettisons so much of the packaging of Buddhism and gets down to this one last stance. Meditate. Leave behind explanations and come instead into realizations. And this is what connects Zen Buddhism all the way back to the early words of the Buddha, Siddhartha Gautama, in India, 1,000 years before Bodhidharma, when Buddha already then told his students, be lamps unto yourselves. Don't follow me. Be lamps unto yourselves.